Hello from the National Football Museum. I'm Belinda from the content team, and welcome to the 7th annual Football Writing Festival. We'd usually be welcoming visitors to the museum for a week-long festival, but we're doing it all online this year. The festival still has a host of top writers, and we're excited to share their featured books with you. If you enjoy the talk, make sure to like, share, and subscribe to keep up with the festival. Today we're joined by Eve Ainsworth, who's talking to us about their new release, The Dick Kerr Girls Kicking Off.
Hiya, lovely to be here.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you for joining us. It's really nice to have you here too. Firstly, can you tell us a little bit about what to expect from the book?
Yeah, certainly. I think there's a lot to expect from the book. Kicking Off is based on a true story. It's based on the Dick Kerr Girls, who are a real football team who formed in 1917 during the First World War in Preston. So they came together, a group of girls that are working together in the factory in Preston, in the Dick Kerr factory. And it was a munitions factory, so they were making weapons at the time. And these young girls came together. At the time, it was kind of encouraged by the government for young women that were working to do exercise and to keep healthy, because obviously they were doing quite physical work. Doing munitions work was very heavy lifting, lots of working with chemicals. It wasn't very nice, pleasant work. So the Prime Minister of the time actually encouraged girls to do exercise and to take recreational breaks. So in their lunch breaks, they used to do a bit of sport to try and keep fit. And the Dick Kerr girls, the girls in this factory, used to play football because it was something they used to see in their hometown. You know, it was something they used to play in the streets with their brothers and friends. So they'd play football really just for fun to begin with, perhaps with some of the apprentice boys that were still there that hadn't gone to war. And something that started as just fun actually became something really good. They actually showed real skill. They played a lot of the apprentice boys, you know, outside on the recreation yard. And there was a funny little antidote about scoring balls through the windows. And the girls showed skills actually a lot of the boys didn't have. And one of the managers at the time saw what they could do and actually formed a team out of the girls, and they went on to play, raise money for war victims, injured soldiers. They raised lots of money, equivalent of millions of pounds today. Their gate sizes were huge, so loads of people came to see them, and they became really popular, especially in the Northwest. The Northwest really became, you know, in love with the Dick Kerr girls and Preston and surrounding areas. And they ended up traveling the world, they ended up traveling the country, and it became really well known. So it's based on this team, this amazing team, this amazing band of girls that played football, that were really, really good, really skillful, that came together at a really difficult time. And they became really well known, but they were hit very hard by, unfortunately, equality laws and prejudices at the time, when the Football Association in 1921 decided that women should not play football and banned all women's football in the UK. And that ban stayed in place until 1971, which is why women's football has been so far behind.
Could I ask, how did you come across their story? How did you find out about the Dick Kerrs?
Well, I'd heard about them quite a few years ago, actually, and I'm trying to remember because I was asked a while ago where I heard it, and I think it was something like Newsround or something when I was quite young. I remember hearing the story of this women's team, and I knew that they were in the Northwest. I knew they were in Preston, and it was something that stayed in my mind, that I knew that there was this successful women's team. And I'd heard, because I'm a real big football fan, I love football. I can't play at all. I really cannot play football, but I've loved football since a young age and I grew up with it. And I've heard of Lily Parr. You know, Lily Parr's probably the most famous Dick Kerr player and probably one of the best football players we've ever produced in England. And I mean, you know, across the board, women and men. And so I'd heard of Lily Parr and I'd heard of the Dick Kerr girls. And it wasn't until my agent, my literary agent, actually contacted me to say that UCLAN, who are part of the University of Lancaster, their publishing arm, wanted to write this book about a football team. And she knew that I was a big football fan. And she said, I don't know if you'd be interested, but it's this female team and they were set up in World War I. And I said, oh my God, the Dick Kerr girls. And she said, yes. And I said, if it's about them, I really, really want to be involved because I know of them and, you know, I'd love to be a part of that because I think there needs to be a book, especially for young people, because actually I think kids can be really inspired by their story, girls and boys, because they came together at a time that was really, really difficult, obviously during the war. But it's a story of friendship, it's a story of hope, it's a story of sport, you know, coming to, you know, sport bringing people together and going against the odds. And it's also a story of, you know, of skill, of girls being really, really good at something. And even though people were against them playing football, they still did it. They still went out there and they still showed what they could do. So it's such an inspiring story that I think, you know, young people need to know about it.
So how long has it taken from the original idea to getting the book published in September this year?
So it took me about 6 months to write, and then it went to an edit process. So I was working quite closely with Gail Newsham, who's a local historian, and she knows everything to do with the Ditka Girls. So we're really lucky to have her on board because she made sure we got all the details correct. We made sure that everything was there that should be. So I'm really thankful we had her on board. So I was working quite closely with her. And in the 6 months, I managed to get together a draft, you know, a good workable draft. And then that went to edit. So with the UCLAN team, we could work together just to make sure that it was all refined and worked together. So probably 6 to 9 months in all. And then obviously went out to publication. We're working on the cover. Really lucky with the cover as well. We've got a lovely cover design. So the team have worked really closely together to make sure that we've got this really complete book that we think can really appeal to readers.
And some of the characters in the book, there's Alice, Lily, Grace, Flo, obviously played for the Ditka Ladies. How do you find blending historical characters within a fictional narrative?
Yeah, I think that's probably one of the most challenging things because I've never done that before. And I was really mindful of the fact that I was working with real people, you know, these girls existed, they were real. And that's probably where Gail came into play quite a bit because I was working quite closely with Gail. And Gail, it really is the expert of all things to do with Ditka Girls. I'm sorry if you hear my dog there. She's the expert to do with all things Ditka Girls. And she knows the families, she knows friends. So she's really in contact. She sort of lives and breathes the team. So as I was writing the girls, you know, if I had a query or a question, I'd go back and I'd sort of say, does this feel right? Does this feel like something that Flo would do? Or does this feel like something that, you know, Alice is like? And actually, weirdly, I was getting it right. You know, it was almost like I was channeling in to the girls, which was lovely. It felt like it was really hitting in. I'd say something to Gail, like, oh, I really feel that Flo's this really feisty, you know, but quite funny character. And Gail would be like, yeah, that's exactly what she is. So it was really nice that how I was feeling, how I was reading the girls was actually how they come across. So they sort of came alive to me. They came alive on paper, which is lovely. And I think the way they played and the little anecdotes that Gail fed me sort of helped me make them come alive as well.
The effects of World War One on a working class community is explored alongside the rights of women. Do you find football a useful lens through which to review social histories?
Definitely. I think it's a really useful lens. I think World War One especially is quite a useful, quite an interesting area to focus on, because I know there's lots and lots of books, especially for young people on World War Two and social aspects. And World War One, I think sometimes we do focus on it, there are books on it, but I think sometimes we don't focus as much. And obviously the community aspect, especially in the northern regions, you know, it really is embedded there. And the community really did come together, you know, in wartime, they really did come together, they really worked together to try and make things better in a really difficult situation. And I think what football shows, and what it showed in the Ditka Girls, is that, you know, the sport, the team, they really did work to try and make things better for the families of the war victims. You know, that's why they were raising money for injured soldiers. You know, they were travelling around, they were trying to raise awareness of what was happening. And they brought joy to the communities. You know, these communities were torn apart. You know, the young men were out there, they were getting hurt, they were dying out there. But they brought joy and they brought hope and they brought something positive and in quite a scary and dark time when a lot of these families were in poverty or, you know, quite scared about their futures. So I think that's where sport comes in, isn't it? Where football comes in, you know, it brings that communities together. It gives them something to focus on, something to support, and something to feel positive about in quite dark times.
Yeah, I agree. I think looking at the First World War, it was such a catalyst for change in so many different ways. So when you bring football into that, it's such a brilliant hook to try and get people interested in so many different types of history. I think it's such a fascinating period.
I think it's a lovely period as well, because it really is. It goes to the roots of football. So, you know, I come from a working class background, and that's another thing what I love about the Ditka girls, is very working class. And football has working class roots, as we know. And I think we're losing that a little bit. Football is losing its working class, you know, angle, because obviously it's not really a working class sport anymore, which is unfortunate. And I think it's good to have a look back into how football started. You know, it really was this working class sport, and it was where families went out together, you know, and it was something that they really looked forward to at the end of a hard working week. And they'd go out and they would actually relax and release those stresses and strains on the ground together and come together. And you really do see that in these games during World War II, World War I and after.
Yeah, if you look at somebody like Lily Parr, what she achieved as, you know, from the working class roots that she had in St Helens, and where she actually ended up and what she achieved is absolutely fascinating. And lots of the, like you say, the women that she played with were from a similar background, and they really did achieve something amazing. Working class women don't achieve that today often. So the fact that they did that in the 1920s or just before is absolutely fascinating, really.
Yeah, so inspirable as well.
Yeah, they really are. And in a related way, have you ever written about football previously, or is this your first football-linked book?
Well, my book before this, actually, funny enough, it's a middle grade book called Lost, and that's focused on football. And it's about a boy who's playing for an academy, or trialing for an academy, a young boy, so very, very football-focused. But that book is more to do with grief, because I wanted to talk about how boys cope with grief and how they cope with showing their emotions, really. And I wanted to show how sport can be a positive way of dealing with difficult times, because this boy, I mean, we're very much, I always say that the Dick Kerr girls and Lost sit kind of hand in hand, because in Lost, I'm kind of showing how we kind of present boys, that boys can't show emotion, boys can't be sad, boys can't cry in front of other people. And in the Ditka girls, I show how girls are told they can't play football, girls can't be like boys. You know, it's the way we're showing, you know, we're presenting different sexes and genders. So Lost was very much about grieving and how we sort of put boys into a box and say, you know, this is how boys should be. And dads as well, it's about his relationship with his dad. But it's how sport and how football kind of help them to heal. So again, it's that relationship with football. So you can see I'm a big football fan, because obviously it does bleed into a lot of my work.
The story is about Hetty finding her place around the team and also in the world. Would you describe it as a coming of age story?
I think so, yeah, because she's quite naive when things start off. You know, she's had quite a, you know, a typical kind of closed life when things start off, before the war kicks off, really. And her dad in particular is quite, you know, quite protective of her and quite controlling of her, as was often the times. And I think for Hetty, she didn't really know where she was in the world. You know, she didn't really know where she belonged. You know, it's a difficult time to be a woman. And I think for her, you know, having the opportunity to work in a factory, to actually do a job, to work with other women, to form these friendships, and then to get involved in sport, and to kind of see the bigger world out there, you know, to see that there's other opportunities and other things she can do. It certainly is a coming of age story for her, because it's really about, you know, questioning what she wants to do with herself and questioning really the world around her and what women can do, what women can achieve if they want to. You know, there isn't restrictions there. The restrictions are put in by other people, not put in by yourself. So it's really Hetty realising that, you know, that she can break these barriers down.
Thank you. You've already touched on this, actually, but sport can bring people together and have such a positive impact. But obviously, in an era without the same film access at the moment, do you think it's harder for young people to engage with these types of stories? And how do you think young people in particular, can engage with these sort of stories at the moment?
It is hard, and I've been saying, because I've been doing quite a few virtual talks with schools and saying that probably now more than ever we need these sort of stories, because I think, you know, times are difficult and they're very difficult for young people, you know, and I think we are feeling a little bit more cut off and probably more cut off from our communities. And funny enough, I was having this conversation with my little boy, because my boy's only 10 and he's really into his sport. You know, when lockdowns happen, everything, sport gets stopped. And it is very hard. It is very hard for young people. And I think that, you know, we have to keep, I mean, I'm always going to be a big advocate of reading, you know, and I think, you know, reading these kind of books, having these types of conversations and remembering that, you know, it's really helpful when we've got books like Kicking Off, because, you know, they are based on true life. So we know that people have been through these sort of things before. You know, young people have been through these things before, and they've overcome them. They've come together and they've overcome them. And I think it's remembering that we can learn from the past and we can move forward. You know, in difficult times we can overcome. And sport is so key to that. You know, sport, friendship, you know, communication with each other. These things are so key. So reading, remembering to talk to one another, you know, when we're having difficult times, you know, tapping into our friendships, tapping into people that we care about. So even if we can't physically be with our communities, it's just still reaching out to them where we can.
This book is obviously about women fighting for equality. What are the challenges today that seem normal but might be reflected on in 100 years' time, and we'll think that shouldn't be the way it was, and the way that we look back now on the ban and what we can reflect on that 100 years later and be flabbergasted that it happened?
Well, there's so many things, isn't there, really, when you think about it. I mean, still in sport, there's still a lot of inequality in sport. And I think it's getting better, but there's still inequality there. And I think that probably in 100 years' time, they'll probably be looking at things and thinking, well, why does men's sport still get, you know, so much priority, for example, on TV? You know, even though women's football is getting more attention, it's taken a long, long time to get there. But other women's sport isn't. You know, I don't see women's rugby or, you know, women's cricket getting as much attention, for example. So we're still a long way behind on that kind of thing. And I think just, you know, even with the media, you know, if you look at newspapers or articles, it's always going to be men's sport is always going to get the priority over women's sport. So there's kind of always this mindset that men's sport is more important and women's is kind of like this little aside. Oh, and by the way, the women are doing this. And that's a frustration. And I think I'd hope to think that in 100 years time that is far more equal. And we'll be looking back at that and thinking, actually, you know, why did we do that? And there's lots of general things. You know, I get frustrated with, my daughter's a big feminist, and we get frustrated by the way that things are divided gender-wise. You know, you still have boy section, girl section. Why is it you walk into a sports shop and you've got girls section and boys section, you know, very much in the sports shop, you know, it shouldn't be like that. And why is a girl's sport section all pink tops? And, you know, it's silly things like that, and the cards that you get, you know. One of my biggest things, and I think I hope in 100 years time that they'll look at doing, but, you know, when you buy a daughter's card, I have never found a daughter's card or a sister card or anything that's feminine that has got sport on it.
Yeah, that's got a football, you know, player on the front.
Yeah, nothing like that. Or, you know, anything related to sport. It's always got sparkly shoes or a pretty dress or something like that. So we're still very much, you know, in our genders. And I think that's something that, you know, needs to be addressed or looked at. Or something certainly in 100 years time, I think we'll probably laugh at and say, you know, why did we do this boy-girl thing? You know, it's so ridiculous. And it's the same for the boys. This is why I had this conversation with Lost. You know, boys aren't all sporty and into cars, you know. So we need to be moving forward from that. You know, it's ridiculous that we're still like this in this day and age.
Yeah, I'd like to think in 100 years time, we'll all look back at newspapers or the sports pages of newspapers. Yeah. And if they aren't gender equal, there's not 50% male sport coverage and female sport coverage, but we'll find that shocking. I hope we're moving towards that, where it is genuinely a 50-50 split, which is obviously what we're trying to do here as well at NFM, is have that 50% representation. And the fact that that's not normal now, that we, you know, we have to make a statement about it being equal, is ridiculous. So hopefully in 100 years time we'll look back and we'll think, and we're glad it's not like that anymore. Yeah, I agree. At the end of the book, we're made aware that the next Dick Kerr novel is on the way. Can you give us any more information about that at this point?
Yep, so literally I've just finished a draft for that one, so I'm quite excited. So the next book is focused on Freddie. So Freddie is Hetty's brother. And so a little bit more of a male point of view on the female team. And Freddie fought in World War One, so you get to see a little bit of his experiences in World War One. So it's really his perspective of coming back from war, and he's quite broken from his war experiences, and he's involved in the team. He's helping the team move forward with their travels. And he forms a friendship with one of the players that comes in, who's had quite a difficult experience as well outside of football. So that's really how they work together. So you see the new players that are joining, you see their French tour that begins, so their first international tour, but you also see from a man's point of view, you know, this female team progress and do well. So yeah, I think it's quite an interesting spin. And then there's going to be a third book, which will be another character narrating. So I think from the three points of view, it's quite interesting.
And I assume that will be sort of post the ban as well, will it? It'll be looking to after 1921 and how that happened.
The idea is to sort of catch it on the ban, so we see that as it ban and then just after, yeah. So we're catching those early years of the Ditka girls, because I think those early years are just so transient. There's so much that's happening in those first. I mean, obviously you could do books going right up, because they obviously turn into the Preston North End girls, and they carry on doing even with the ban, they carry on travelling through America. So you could take the books a lot further, but I just think those early years, so much happens that's so key to how they develop. I think that's the interesting part to focus on.
Yeah, I think it would be great to tell younger people about the fact that they carried on as well, that even despite the ban, they just adapted and changed and still continued to fight, to play football and did, all like you say, all the way up to the Preston Ladies. So I think that's a fascinating story. So that'd be great to read about that as well.
Definitely.
A huge thanks for joining us at this special Manchester Football Writing Festival talk from the National Football Museum. We have a full week of author Q&As to look forward to, so please take a look at our channel. To find out more information about the festival and the museum, go to thenationalfootballmuseum.com. Thanks for watching, and we hope to see you again soon.